Bad Company. Plus, we're going to have some Twisted Sister, Overkill, Manowar, Vinnie Vincent, Halloween, Shy, Alice Cooper, and possibly Ozzy on the phone. That's all in part two of the programme. In the first section of tonight's show, well, it revolves around a son of Yorkshire who's been right at the centre of British rock music for a long, long time. Now, to my left, I've got a pile of letters. Some of them may be from you. To my right, I've got a stack of records, both old and new, by various bands. And directly in front of me, I've got David Coverdale, to whom I say welcome to this programme.
Good evening, Tommy.
How are you?
Old.
Well, you've got one thing in your favour. You're never going to be as old as me.
Oh, I don't know.
You look remarkably well, even though you're working hard.
Mm. Yeah, thank you very much.
Because you are. This time around, you're talking to all the press, virtually, to
for the first time in history.
Yeah, but you are. I mean, you're going out of your way to make your point and put yourself about.
Yeah, well, there's a great deal of many questions I think people need answering.
Okay. Well, I've got a stack of letters from people who listen to this programme, and I'll be putting their questions to you after we start the music.
Well, it does stuff.
Does you good, though, doesn't it?
Pacey's the star of that track. Pacey's great.
He's a ripping drummer.
So good.
Ripping drummer. Burn from 1974. David Coverdale is our guest on the programme. And I just went on the air and I said to people, send in questions. So I've got a pile of questions.
David Coverdale, this is your life.
Not, could be nearly, I tell you, because they're asking things like this. Who, what is the magnet?
Oh, the magnet was a road manager that used to work for Ian, then worked for me and Ian, and then me. Is a guy called John Ward, charming chap from the Midlands.
That's Magnet.
Yes, Magnet.
Okay,
Paul. He got the name Magnet because when he was working with Zeppelin, he attracted women 365 days a year.
Did he? No wonder he looked so haggard the last time I saw him. Paul, the Snake fan, asked that question. He also asked this: what is your secret with women?
Honesty.
And Paul, if you believe that, you believe anything. And he'll
buy this kite.
Alan Place of Easton in Bristol says, where did you get the name Whitesnake and what does it mean?
It was a song that I wrote actually for if Purple would make another solo album, it would have been on there. Yeah. However, we didn't, so I put it on the first solo album I did. Mm-hmm. And use your imagination, Alan.
Yeah, because it is that, isn't it? I mean, it's unbroadcastable, really.
Yes, don't call me Willie.
No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't in a million years. Valerie Zitsinski lives in... Zitsinski. Don't knock her. Lives in Forest Row in Sussex. She says, I only discovered Whitesnake about 2 years ago. I was busy with babies and children right before that.
Well, that was... Yes, oh, she discovered it before then.
Exactly. And she goes, honestly, where can I get a potted history of Whitesnake? I've tried the fan club but got no reply.
That's pretty obvious, yeah. I mean, neither do I. What did she discover?
She wants a potted history.
A potted history.
Have you?
I think Whitesnake was the title of her first solo album in 76 or 7. Mm-hmm. And when I formed the group in 78 or 79 or 80, I thought, why not? That's pretty potted.
That's potted.
If you want any more, ask Robert Plant.
Okay, he'll tell you all. Here's a tune.
Potted Plant.
It's 18 and a half minutes past 10. You're listening to the Friday Rock Show from BBC Radio 1. Played it there from a CD, which is probably only available in this country, I think, on import. In fact, I don't think it's released here at all.
Or by bribery.
It cost you a few bob anyway.
Honest 12 inches from Whitesnake.
He said it again. Still of the Night. That's the single. It's out at the moment. David Coverdale is my guest here on the programme. And yeah, thanks for buying the beer. I haven't had a beer on the air for a long time.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Well, you're more than welcome.
Thank you. It's very nice. Back to the questions. I don't even know who sent this in because there's no address on it or anything like that. It says, is it true, David Coverdale, that you asked Gary Moore, according to a Krang interview some time ago, to join Whitesnake 9 times?
No.
8 times?
No. There was talk of us working together. There wasn't any situation of invitations. It was, 82. Mm-hmm. 82, Gary came over. I was trying to finish off the Saints and Sinners album in January 82. And Gary came back from America. And he said, you know, what's going to happen and stuff. And he said, would I do some work on a solo album of his? And I said, yeah, I'd be delighted to. But at this moment in time, I really don't know what I'm going to do with Whitesnake or my career. Yeah. So I said, don't hold me to it. And then we talked sort of bits and pieces about over bottles of vodka, you know, about working together, but it didn't come out.
Nothing came of it.
No.
What do you think of his progress in rock
and
roll?
Fine. I encouraged him to sing, to be honest.
Yeah. He's really getting there, isn't he? He's a bit raspy for a while.
Mm, absolutely.
Always been a good guitarist.
Mm-hmm.
Electric. Electric.
He's an electric guitarist, yeah.
Is that? Yeah, he is. Really. I haven't seen him do a lot of Spanish work recently.
Aye.
Okay, Luton in Bedfordshire is the home of Mickey King, who says this. How did Dave feel about the reformation of Deep Purple? Did he feel that he was left out? Because I felt he contributed more to Deep Purple than he's credited for. And to me, an old Purple fan, the current lineup should have had the grace to include him in some way. Maybe as a guest on some of the shows of their tour, it would have been a nice gesture anyway.
They offered me the roadies job, I think. Anyway, I'd like to ask the gentleman who wrote the letter if he'd like to be my manager.
Mickey King.
Mickey, would you like to manage me?
All right, Mickey. He's probably on the way to Broadcasting House now.
No, whatever it would have... Had I been invited, I would have passed on it. Not through arrogance or anything, just through the fact that I'm very happy with what I'm doing now. Mm. And I didn't want to particularly go... I don't want to go back. I want to learn from the past. I don't want to live in it. Mm. And I was very happy and very honoured to be involved with Deep Purple when I was. However, I'm delighted to be doing what I am now.
So that puts all that to bed?
Does it?
Well, I think so.
I certainly hope so.
Right. I'll ask you what you're doing now, other than the release of the album later.
Drinking.
Right. So am I. But not a lot, honestly, Director General. Andy and Fran Berry of Pontypool. Why has it been such a long time between the last vinyl offering? I mean, what you've been doing, that's basically what they're saying.
Well, 85 was spent writing the songs, looking for a drummer, and starting off the recording. It was all legitimate stuff, and unfortunately, all of 86, I was very ill. It was not my choice. It was a gift from God, which he usually slaps me on the back of the head and says, things aren't going to be so smooth, young Coverdale. Well, that was when I was younger. Now it's not quite so complimentary. I had no choice. I was very, very ill. It took me an illness of 9 months, a true pregnancy. And fortunately, I did get the voice back, but at the beginning, there was no guarantee.
Uh-huh.
And the voice was recorded after the illness and the surgery. So, from what I've been told, it's better than ever. I certainly hope so.
So, it's a combination of illness and writing songs and indecision. Any indecision involved in it at all? Any
not at all. Not at all.
No.
Although it was a nightmare at the time, I'm delighted to go. I went through it for the cleansing of the spirit, as it were. And I apologize to people that it took so long, but I really didn't have any choice at all.
Okay. This is your choice I'm going to play now.
Tush, baby.
ZZ Top and a classic, which is called Tush, which was the choice of my guest here on the programme today, or rather tonight, because it's 25 minutes past 10, Mr. David Coverdale.
Desperately romantic track.
It is, isn't it?
Yes.
That's all about...
Less than 3 minutes of wonder.
Seen them live a few times?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I had the pleasure of working with them. They came to see me in America. It's a kind of mutual admiration society. I've been an admirer of them for many, many years.
Yeah. Best gig I ever saw them do was at the Marquee in front of 150 people.
Oh, superb.
It was unbelievable. I mean, you could get up so close to the stage, obviously.
Mm. You can smell the beard.
You could smell everything.
Spinal Tap title, wasn't it? Smell the beard.
I can't remember that. But just watching them and being able to move around and watch each individual
and
work.
And smelling them, knowing the Marquee.
Yeah. Well, because, I mean, you know, the Marquee's like classic.
Superb.
If you rung it out,
there's
London legend. Would be drink.
There's legends written in the walls.
Mm. And a few songs.
Mm-hmm.
That Ties and Fiona, I think it's Ties or Chaz or something in Fiona. Want me to ask you this. If somebody was to cover one of your songs, how much commission would you take if the single was successful or not?
I would probably get the publishers and the writers credit.
Yeah.
Which is substantial.
So you'd be all right for a few, Bob?
It depends if it sold more. If it went more than tin in Ecuador, yeah.
Andy Powell, Swindon, Wiltshire.
Any relation? Any relation?
Please says, ask this of Mr. Coverdale. Why does he always surround himself with musicians who look like geriatrics and are as about as exciting to watch on stage as a bunch of geriatrics having a race?
Are you sure this is the Moody Blues we're talking about? No, I surround myself with musicians, Andy.
Fair enough, fair comment. There you go, Mr. Powell. Let's put you in your place. Andy Powell, incidentally, is a member of a band called First Strike. Good luck.
Well, there you go.
Tony Byron of Congleton, Cheshire. Right. Dear David, would you confirm that you will be joined by Vivian Campbell, Adrian Vandenberg, Rudy Zarzo, and also Tommy Aldrich for a British tour in June? If so, who's going to be playing keyboards?
No.
Fine. Will you have a keyboard player, though? Because people have actually asked that.
No, that's... I sort of got a bunch of people together to work with me on the video, and it was so positive, there is a possibility of us working together. However, it has been such a long time, I don't want to take these people away from their current situations unless there's some guarantee I can take care of them. They are exquisite players and very fine people, and most important, very positive human beings. And their attitude is rock and roll, and I hope that it would come off. I will do my utmost to assure that.
It's been a tradition in rock music, in rock and roll, and even, I suppose, in big band jazz, that people who are at the front sometimes go off and do their own thing and put people and surround themselves with
usually
people.
During the drum solo.
Yeah, indeed, during the drum solo. And in other words, what I'm saying is that all these people seem to have, if you like, a go at you, because they're always saying, why has he changed musicians? He fires the musicians. Well, who's in the band today? Ask him who's in the band this week, next week, and the week after.
Yeah, well,
but there's a tradition of people actually going from the front and becoming the band.
Yeah, well, it's not really my choice all the time. Certain situations dictate what should be done. My responsibility is purely and simply the audience who recognize the identity of Whitesnake, which is just that it's supposed to be a vehicle for good songs, that's all. And if the personalities interfere with that premise, it's a fond farewell, or whatever. I won't be compromised in any way, privately or professionally. I'm there to perform, and that's it.
Spoken like a true Yorkshireman.
Damn right, chap.
Whitesnake. 1987, the album is called, or at least it is called 87 in this country. Is it just Whitesnake in the States?
Well, I wanted to call it Liquor and Poker and have a bottle of Jack on the front and five cards, you know, or No Muff Too Tough, you know. I mean, just to encourage the critic.
But unfortunately, the shares of EMI would go down.
Ian, you've changed.
He's looking at the engineer. He won't talk to me anymore.
Good Lord. But where did you buy that, Fredericks?
Which title does it have in the...
Which title does
States.
It have?
Is it called 1987 or Whitesnake?
No, it's just called Whitesnake. Or Whip It Out, Wipe It, and Slide It Back In Again. I don't know, one of those things. Whitesnake.
Who cares what it's called?
Precisely correct.
It's there.
It's what's
right?
In the grooves.
Exactly. Mansfield, Nottingham. You've been there?
Yes.
Fine. Somewhere in Mansfield, Nottingham, there's Chris Hopkins, age 17. Question. How does David Coverdale spend his spare time?
looking for inspiration for songs.
Really?
Mm.
Are you an easy writer?
Easy writer, yeah. Call me Henry or Peter. Is Peter fonder of the things that David wrote? Yeah, relatively. I usually have ideas most of the time from observations of what I get up to. And then I go away for a particular period of time where there's no telephones or telexes or TVs and stuff and put them all together, correlated.
Do you write the music first or lyrics?
It depends. It depends.
Whichever. Mm. Whichever way it runs, yeah.
As long as it comes out in the end.
Okay. This is Kate. This is a question by...
Oh, a woman.
A woman.
Splendid.
Indeed, from Doncaster. P.S. This is the P.S. to a very long letter. Could you please tell me how David Coverdale keeps that beautiful body of his in such perfect shape, or maybe I shouldn't ask?
Maybe you shouldn't ask, Kate. However, I look forward to meeting you and showing you just what I do to stay in shape.
And that leads me to the question, when are you going to tour?
I've been talking with a couple of chappies, Rod McSween, are you out there, about making some sneaky appearances.
Yeah.
I would like very much to perform live, very much. It's been too long, far too long. In essence, I am a live musician. I hope so, anyway. That's the true inspiration for creating rock and roll, comes from an audience.
Yep.
But you know, that's the fire, that's the passion.
With the greatest of respect, that does not answer my question, which is not necessarily my question, but it's also everybody else's, because we've had phone calls, I've got piles of letters, and the predominant question is, when do we get to see the act?
As soon as I can. I swear to God.
Yeah? This year? Next year?
Yes, this year. It will be. I'll come out with a bass drum on my back and a pair of cymbals on the knees, anything, acoustic guitar.
And do Rosie.
Don Coverdale, yeah. Don Coverdale, the Godfather.
Final question for this segment of the program. Have you ever thought of doing any acting in films?
I've been approached several times.
Mm-hmm.
Conan the Barbiturate was one. Attila the Nun, and it's always Danish.
Well, that was the question of Miss Mavis Travis, and I hope she liked the answer.
Mavis, I miss you, dear.
You've chosen a track from an old album.
Yes, this features the word love. How unusual.
I Need Love.
Don't we all?
We got it back in 1975. The choice of David Coverdale, who's our... Oh, we're just having a chat. Guests always sound so formal.
Can I just compliment the BBC on these headphones?
Do you like them?
No, it's like wearing a commode.
Two commodes, one on each side.
Yeah, a pair of commodes, yes.
Just to help the listener here, as they're supposed to help the listener.
It's like having two coffee cups on your ears.
They are the oldest GPO. The GPO is, pulled apart years and years.
Graham Parsons organisation.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, the oldest GPO headphones are provided by the BBC for absolutely for nothing. I think it's wonderful. But not only that, David, I'm here to tell you that these headphones are now your property.
Oh, wonderful and wacky.
But not very expensive, as far as the BBC is concerned.
Oh, not at all.
I want you to, don't you, look after them. They're dreadful. Shame it's not television, you know what we're talking about. Have you had your wisdom teeth sorted out?
And for those of you with black and white, the pink one is behind people, the blue ball.
I'm just asking people's questions. I mean, this is Mike Southern from somewhere.
Can we organise Dave-Aid?
Dave-Aid?
Or Glands Across America. Something like
that. That doesn't answer his question.
What does he want here? Did I ever get my wisdom teeth problem sorted out? Yes, I was sucking raw cloves for a month till I could meet the dentist. Yes, fortunately I did. But I'm sure something else is going to rear its ugly head soon. God, I hope not. I'm wearing a wetsuit.
Okay, acting in films, we've covered that one, haven't we? How many songs have you got in... Oh, have you got any in the can still?
These particular headphones? That's all bits and pieces all the time. I've got a nice new one where there are too many tears falling, there are too many hearts... broken into, nice little boogie tune. Mm-hmm. Yeah, little bits and pieces all the time. It's very difficult because there's constant distraction, interference all the time. So until I can have some time to go away and put these pieces together, correlate, it's like a musical jigsaw. Mm-hmm. It's difficult. But all the things are filed away in the human computer. He's tapping his head, for those of you with black and white. at this moment in time, I haven't any desire whatsoever to go back into a recording studio for some time.
I bet you haven't.
Quite enough, thank God.
3 years, a long time. Long project.
3 minutes is a long time.
How much did it cost you, can I ask you this?
Really? You want me to relive this grief?
No, not if you don't want to.
Over $700,000.
That's a lot of bread, no.
There was no choice. I mean, it's cost more than all the Whitesnake stuff put together. And there was no choice. It just went on and on and on. Terrible. Availability, studios booked here, illness interfered with this, interfered with that. If you block book a studio, you have to honour the agreement with the people.
You actually recorded in, what, at least three
Whitesnake,
different
studios? The Whitesnake World Tour of studios. You know, Vancouver, Toronto, Los Angeles, Bahamas, London, let me see, is there a studio in Teesside? I would have had a go there, probably.
There is, actually.
You name it, we did it.
They went everywhere, folks. But the album's out now. How has the response been to it elsewhere than in the UK?
Well, the only negative we get is it's like a percentage of the UK press, which goes for the character assassination rather than the musical critique. But they're welcome to the pseudo-intellectual squalor, because I'm not interested. You know, I was disappointed because these are the first things that surfaced. Everywhere else is absolutely positive and always has been. It's wonderful. If I made records for critics, I'd be lucky to afford a bicycle.
Is the album out in all territories now?
To a certain extent, yeah. I think we were trying to arrange for a worldwide release, simultaneous release.
So that really means you're also going to have to arrange a worldwide tour.
I certainly bloody hope so, Tommy.
Good.
Hey, Joe.
Yeah? Oh, good. Jimi Hendrix recorded live in Monterey. The track was Hey Joe. It was the choice of David Coverdale, who's having a chat with us here on the front.
I love that man.
Oh, he was great. I love that version as well.
Oh, wonderful stuff.
Great. He was a nice geezer as well.
Also an unbelievable inspiration.
Yeah.
A multitude of sins. It's fabulous.
But he overdosed, didn't he? Like a lot of people who did in the world of rock and roll. Not too many opera singers seem to pop their clogs.
Have you seen The Meat?
Okay, so they do it that way. But
show me a skinny operator.
Go on, after you.
No, show me a skinny opera singer.
No, but I mean overdose on drugs, basically, is what I'm talking about.
Dreadful stuff. I don't know. The problem is that you're elevated to such a point when you're on stage or in a successful enterprise, whereas you feel superhuman and you think you can do whatever you want. Also, on the periphery, there are always people ready to try to indulge you, to get closer to you.
Yeah.
And it's wrong.
Crawls.
Wrong.
And it's
a, Dreadful. Poo.
It's such a shame, actually, when it happens, because I always seem to have to do the obituaries. And I've been, you know, like doing Phil Lynott's obituary.
Well, it's also happened to a lot of very close friends and colleagues. Yeah. Anyway, so it's very bitter and resentful.
It's a bummer. Okay, on a lighter note, Sarah McKinley of Rosslyn, Midlothian, says, please, may I have a signed photograph of yourself, because I'm a great fan, and so is my mother.
Well, I have been doing it for a while. How you doing, Mum?
There you go. Will you do an autograph on the back of that letter?
I would be honoured.
Right. My girlfriend...
Oh, it's from my lawyer.
David Fletcher says, my girlfriend lawyer, also Laura, not lawyer, also wants to know, if you tour, which you're going to do before the end of the year because you promised, will you please sing Time and Again for her?
Ooh, well, there's something very close coming up. Something... Yeah, I will have a go, but there's something close coming up. The same sentiment.
Okay, stay tuned for that, but a final question for this segment. Do you not also think that the inclusion of the two tracks from Saints and Sinners aims the market too much towards America and leaves the true fans, i.e. the Brits, out a little? Now, who says that load of rubbish? Sorry, Alan Bond.
Just a second, did you call me segment?
No, I didn't, not at all.
I thought you said this segment.
Taller.
Hope that they trust that I'm trying to give them the best. I can only do the best I can at that particular time, and I've never ever presented anything. I personally was disappointed with Saints and Sinners because I thought they were some of the best songs I'd been involved with ever. And unfortunately, at that time, the attitude of some of my colleagues was not exactly up. It was a bit lazy. Whitesnake were extraordinarily successful in 81, and unfortunately, it gave some people the feeling of, well, we've made it, we don't have to do any more. You know, and it was very, very disappointing. It was actually an inspiration to re-record two of my favourite songs on this album.
Right. You just asked me to play this track, and I think you've got a dedication.
Oh, yes, indeed. This is to a very, very good friend of mine called Fish, and to his wonderful woman, Tamara. This is for your nuptials, and I know it is love. However, the question is this love?
From the latest Whitesnake album, the track called Is This Love? That's going to become a classic. You know, I really think it is. It's such a beautiful song, yet it has all the strength that you put into slow ballads.
Yeah, a bit of blues.
Yeah, a bit of blues.
B-I-T-T-E-R.
Nicely said. Mikhail Malmgren is a fella.
From Poland?
No, Sweden, mate.
I'll go afton.
whatever that means, I hope you haven't got me fired. He says, when and where did you start to sing?
Sven, I... when and where? Apparently, according to my mother, it was the first day at school, in the infant school, in the Northeast, Princess Street Junior School. Apparently, I went through the whole top 10, and the top singer at that time, oh God, this is aging me, was Tommy Steele singing the blues, cover version. Right. And so I've been singing the blues since I was 4 or 5.
That's wild. I mean, because are you a natural singer? I always think of you as being a natural singer.
No, it's all cognac and cigarettes.
No, it blooming well isn't.
Liquor and poker.
Yeah. Oh, sure. You're not going to fall into that one either.
No, no, no. I got... Really, the actual inspiration was that since I'd been 7 years old, I'd wanted nothing more than to be an artist. But the Yorkshire sensibility turned around and said, there's not a lot of money in that. You know, so I trained to be a graphic design artist and an art teacher. But what I found when I was painting and stuff or drawing, I had to explain all the time what I was trying to get at with this particular piece. Whereas if I sang... You know, spontaneously, if happy or sad, people identified immediately and understood what I was getting at immediately. Mm-hmm. And that was an inspiration. The first actual gig I did with an electric group, I got a chicken sandwich and a Coca-Cola at the Top Hat Club in Saltburn by the Sea. And I thought, this is good. You get fed when you sing.
You and have fun.
You get fed for having fun, yeah, really.
What was the first band that you were in that ever got any recognition?
Deep Purple. I actually joined two bands that had won Opportunity Knox with the famous Hughie Green. One was called The Skyliners, and one was called Rivers Invitation. Unfortunately, the spotlight was denied me because I joined them après the event. But I actually got wage packets at 17 as a student. 12 quid a week, I think it was.
So you're a professional musician from the off, really?
No, I thought, this is good, this. You can get paid for having a lot of fun.
That was still like Yorkshire sensibility, eh?
And travel.
And travel. Paul T says, wish his wife Maureen happy birthday for tomorrow.
Maureen, I wish you the most wonder-filled day of your life.
And also, he goes on to say, what is the most memorable live performance you've done?
Oh, there's been a couple. One of them was in Newcastle when... I think the first headlining tour, the first sort of major venue tour of Whitesnake, and the audience took over Ain't No Love in the Heart of a City. Mm. It killed me. I mean, it was all
over. It's
always
a great moment.
And then if anybody has the video from the Donington show, it was all over for Coverdale when the audience took over. It just got bigger and bigger and bigger. I don't know whether the actual power of the audience singing at the Monsters of Rock in 83 came across on the video, but it was all over for me. You know, there are certain times through my career, which a lot of people won't understand, but intimates will, when I thought, I'm going to stop now. It can't get any better than this. It can't get any more pleasure. It can't get nicer than this particular moment. And I've considered stopping. Mm-hmm. You know, no practicality, no thought, just reacting emotionally. And I actually sort of broke down. If you look closely, it's all over. You know, the serious wetness into the eyes. Mm-hmm. And Cozy sort of rescued me by kicking the band back in. Because yeah. I was gone.
But you do like, I mean, I've watched you from the front house often, and also from the side of the stage a lot, and you really do throw yourself into live performance. But you're also a hard taskmaster, because you're also looking back all the time to making sure that other people are following.
It's called Dolly's Dagger. Turn around. Apparently you can melt guitar strings at 30 paces. Yeah. You know, that's only if something occurs, because it's up to me to, you know, to seduce the audience, to work them. And the people I work with, I trust 100% to be doing the same. Mm. But every so often there's a hiccup and it's like, ooh, serious job. There's also a good one on the Donington video as well.
I haven't seen that video. I must go and nick it from somewhere.
You have lived. However, it is, you know, a record of the time.
I was there. I saw it being made. It's coming up to 11 o'clock, which means that we've run out of time, as they say on the radio. But I'd just like to say, welcome home. The album's exceptionally good.
Thank you.
For God's sake, get back on the stage and make us all happy once again.
I look forward to it, I swear to you.
All right, mate. David
this is
Coverdale.
For the shark.
For the shark. Well, just before I play it, for the shark, David Coverdale, thanks.
Thank you, Tommy.
Straight for the heart, David Coverdale. The album's called Whitesnake 1987. It's out now. Well, the knockers can knock and the critics can criticize, but in all the years I've been a follower of David Coverdale and Whitesnake, and you have probably too, neither you or I have walked away from a gig without going, yeah, that was the way to do it, and feeling a great sort of sense of achievement about watching an act, whoever has been in the band, watching an act that gives you what you want. Straightforward, down the line, rock and roll. Radio.